Your prayer can be the one that sits that.
All right, guys, let's get right into it. We're continuing our overall theme of love and obedience through faith, but we're going to start a new series, if you want to call it that, of the next few times that I'll be ministering. I'll be ministering on three main words: identity. If you want to write these down, identity, intimacy, and integrity. I'll be ministering those. And in today's title is simply, why stay down? You have a crown. Got it? I think out there on our sign we put, why stay down? Go to the crown. But we need to remember, I have a crown. Amen? Say, I have a crown. Say, I am victorious. That's what happens. You get a crown when you're a king, when you reign, when you're victorious. You are it when you get a crown. Amen? Is a crown a good thing? Yes. It's a very good thing. All right. So, if you need titles, there's some titles for you. But have any of you ever played the game Chutes and Ladders? Yeah. Remember that game growing up? Okay. Now, maybe you played it as a child. It could frustrate even the most unflappable sometimes. You're going along, you're moving, you're going up a ladder, you're like, yes! And then all of a sudden, here comes a chute. And you go right back down. And then you go along some more, and you go up a ladder, and everything's going great, and here we go! And then you hit another chute. All right? You may do your very best to go along there, but you feel like what you've been given that you have no control over. That you get to go up, and then you get to go down. Anybody ever feel like that in life? Things are going great. Here we go. And then boom, we hit a chute. And then all of a sudden, we get back into maybe doing good things. And we think, all right, I'm back on track. And we're going up. And then we hit another chute. And maybe it's a chute that you cause. Or maybe it's a chute that you feel like comes out of nowhere. But whatever it is, you feel like you're going up and then down and then up and then down. But see, the goal of chutes and ladders is at the very end, you're trying to get to the finish, right, is your goal. And a lot of times people see life as, my goal is to get to the finish. And what do most people, and what's all our goal? Our goal is to get to where? Heaven, right? We want to be in heaven. We do. I mean, I do. Do you want to? Yeah. Okay. So yes, that's a goal. But here's the thing that we're going to talk about today. When Jesus said, it is finished, you know what he did in that whole chutes and ladders game? He skipped all the chutes and ladders and he put you right to the top. Because what did he say? He said, it is finished, right? He didn't say, let's go up and down and then that'll determine whether you can be with me or not. He said, no, it is finished. We're done with chutes and ladders. You can just spend time with me right here. You don't have to earn getting to heaven. And if you go too far down, you don't have to think that, oh, you're going to lose it. No, you can go right to him right now. Anybody want to play that kind of chutes and ladders game? Yeah. I mean, there are some people that it just seems like drama is attracted to them. And like they're in it for the thrill of life. And maybe you feel like that's you. Let's get out of that today. Okay? And I'm not saying you'll never see another chute. But instead of responding like, oh no, here they come, or here it comes, when it rains, let's get rid of that mindset. When it rains, it stops raining, and I get to be dry, okay? But see, a lot of times we get into this mindset because the culture does, everybody does. When things are going bad, it's probably going to keep going bad. No, watch your words, and just because you're sick, start saying, I'm healed. Just because a car broke down, start saying, man, this car's an awesome car. And if you want to get rid of it, pray you can sell it for a good price. But don't have the mindset of, man, everything goes wrong for me. No, it is finished. I'm going to be living victoriously, not chutes and ladders. Yeah. All right. Now, you may feel like that today. But one of the, and I'll let you know, I got this analogy from a book that I just started reading this week by Alan Platt. He has a 30,000 member church in South Africa, and I got to hear him speak this week, and it's really awesome. And he used this. I'm like, that is awesome. And what he was talking about from a spiritual concept is people think that the ladders are the good works. If I do good, God's going to reward me. If I keep trying to do that, every church thing that we have here at Spirit Life Church, if I do all those, God's going to reward me. Okay? Because we've been talking about love and obedience through faith. But I want us to back up a minute. God loves you. Say, God loves me. Okay? God loves you whether you are obedient or disobedient. God loves you. The issue is, you show God you love Him by your obedience. But it's not because you're obedient that He loves you. And the obedience is because you love Him. You want to do it. You're not forced to do it. You're not trying to get to heaven through it. You're not trying to outdo somebody else. I'm not trying to do more good things than Brother Luke. Although, maybe I am. Okay, no, I'm just doing what God has for me. Okay, it's not a competition in that sense. Now, I like to win. Anybody else like to win out there? We like to win. Okay? But see, we are all winners when it comes to the game of life in the essence of, I have the victory through Christ Jesus, my Lord. Okay? All right. Now, go ahead and put that chutes and ladders picture up there for us again. They kind of had it up there. So our beginning point of the message today is not that we start at the bottom of chutes and ladders. It's that we start at the top of chutes and ladders. Okay? And I'll explain to you kind of those ups and downs, what those are in different things. But you have to remember, who you are in Christ is not defined by the game, by the board, by the board of your life of going up and down. That is not who you are in Christ. You're not a roller coaster ride. Okay? Say, I'm not a roller coaster ride. You don't go up and down. Say, I go up. What's the scripture say? And you hear us say this a lot here at Spirit Life Church because we need to hear it. We go from faith to faith, glory to glory, increase to increase, more and more. Amen? When I got a hold of that revelation, it changed my life because I thought bad things had to happen to me because that made me draw closer to God. That if I had have some bad things happen, I would be closer to God. Do you know that's not scriptural? It's not. Okay. Now, while you're going through something, you may draw near to God. That's great, but that's not the purpose of it. It's not to draw you near to God. You should already be drawing near to God. Okay. The Bible says, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. It doesn't say go through a bunch of bad things in your life and I'll get closer to you. No. So it's about just us taking the initial step of I'm going to draw near to God and not go through a bunch of stuff. That sound good? Okay. Now, let's go to Deuteronomy 28, verse 13. Because I want you to know this has always been God's mindset. His mindset has always been that you start on top. His mindset has always been that you can be the victor, not the victim. And I'm not speaking against people who've been through stuff, okay? We've all been through something. I know you have. But you can't continue to have a victim mentality if you want to be a victor in life, okay? All right, look at somebody, say, you're not a victim anymore. Say, you're a victor, okay? All right, we start at the top. In Deuteronomy 28, verse 13, it says, the Lord will make you the, go ahead and say that again. The Lord will make you the, where's the head at? It's on top, right? Is the head underneath? The head's on top. He'll make you the head and not what? Not the? Where's the tail at? It's on your bottom. Okay? That's what we tell our kids. That's your bottom. All right? The tail's on the bottom. The head's at the top. Which is a better place to be? The top, right? Where does God want you to be? He wants you to be on top. He wants you to be the head and not the tail. He wants you to be above and not beneath. I know we teach it, and I know we know that here at Spirit of Life Church, but there's times when we go through something, we got to reset for a minute. We got to say, wait a minute, where am I supposed to be? And maybe you need to tell somebody when they start just going through everything, and this is blah, 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 and you just stop and say, whoa, wait a minute. Where are you supposed to be? Where are you at? Say, I'm on top. Okay, if you were here a few years ago when Brother Jesse Duplantis was here, Dr. Jesse Duplantis, he talked about being on the top of the barrel. And I got those DVDs and I watched them. And it stirred me up that, yes, I'm supposed to be the cream of the crop on top. I'm not supposed to be the bottom that sinks to the bottom. We're not supposed to sink. We're supposed to rise. Amen? And it's not because of you. It's because of who's in you. Okay? Now, let me give you one of our theme verses we've been using. 1 John chapter 5, verses 3 to 4. Is this starting to stir you up? I tell you, we got some stuff that's really going to get you going before you leave here today. Okay, 1 John chapter 5, verses 3 to 4 says, "For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith." Now let me speak to you, make sure I know that you know who you are. Are you born again? Raise your hand if you're born again, okay? All right, if somebody didn't raise their hand, lay hands on them and pray for them right now. Just kidding. But I want you to be confident knowing that you're born again. If you're not born again, you need to stop one of us, for real. This isn't playing. You need to stop one of us and say, hey, I need to get born again today. And to get born again, you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, raised Jesus from the dead, and you will be saved. Amen? That's what we believe. And then your life will change. You'll have a change happen on the inside of you, and you will want to start living for God and being obedient to him. But you, number one, have to know you're born again. Say, I'm born again. And not just know it, but know that you know that you know that you're born again. Because it says here that if I know I'm born again, whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. And it talks before that about obeying God. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So it shows you that God's saying, if you want to be victorious, you do need to obey me. Okay? He's not saying, I will love you if you obey me. He says that if you just want to have victory, you need to obey me. Okay? You get that? All right. Now, let's go into Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. Because we want you to have good works. We want you to do what the Lord's telling you to do. But you need to know you're not saved by works. All right? Look here in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. Verse 8 says, "For by grace," say thank you for his grace, "by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God." Can you earn it? Can you take it? You can take it by faith, but you can't take it without faith, all right? We receive grace through faith, okay? For by grace we receive grace because he's awesome, but by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Say, no one. Paul couldn't even boast. Paul said, I'm going to boast, but he said, he's saying here, no one can boast. The only reason he boasted is because everybody else is telling about all their stuff. He said, wait a minute, let me tell you about my stuff. And he said, he didn't use the word embarrassed, but basically he felt like, I feel kind of silly having to tell you guys this, but I'm just going to tell you how it is. But he's saying here, we don't need stuff. We can't use stuff to get near to God. Not only to get near to him, but to have what God wants us to have here. We can't earn it. I can't earn healing. You realize that? You cannot earn your healing. You cannot earn your prosperity. You cannot earn the awesome life that God has for you. You cannot earn it. You have to receive it. You have to say, I'm going to start. I have it now. Say, I have it now. Now, it says, not a result of work so that no one can boast. For we are his workmanship. Which is a Greek word for workmanship there is poema. which we've talked about here. Different guest ministers have talked about this. But that, so think of a poem, how well a poem is written and how those words just seem to go together. Awesome. That's how God has made you for good works, that you are working in the things of God that you're supposed to be. God has a plan, a purpose for you. If you've been coming on Wednesday nights, we've been stirring you up in that. Okay, God, what do you have for me? I know you have something for me. We can't teach it all on Sunday morning. That's why we have Wednesday. All right? But God, he wants you, you are his workmanship. Put your hand on your heart. Say, I am his workmanship. He has something for me. Say this, say, and I am good at it. And I will do it well. In Jesus' name. You are his workmanship. You're created in Christ Jesus for good works. He didn't say that because of good works I'm created in Christ Jesus, did it? It didn't say good works, I get to be with God. It says no. It says here that created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. So for those good works to take place, though, you have to be obedient. I'm not going to do good things unless I'm listening to God. If I listen to God, I'm going to be lined up with those good works. That make sense? Okay, but those good works do not, they do not, that's not what gets you saved, and that's not what gets you to where you can receive from God, okay? Look at Galatians chapter 3, verse 3. The good works you do not qualify you, justify you, verify you, anything-fy you. Okay, they can't. And this is what Paul had to address this to the Galatians. He had to say, whoa, whoa, whoa. He says here, and this is the New Living Translation, says, how foolish can you be? After starting your new lives in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort? The Message Bible, watch this. The Message Bible says, are you going to continue this craziness? For only crazy people would think they could complete by their own efforts what was begun by God. If you weren't smart enough or strong enough to begin it, how do you suppose you could perfect it? Can I read that one again? I think that really tells you how it is. It's how my wife talks to me a lot of times. It just tells me how it is. Are you going to continue this craziness? For only crazy people would think. Any crazy people out there? Two of you, raise your hand. Tell them they're not crazy. Okay? For only crazy people would think they could complete by their own efforts what was begun by God. If you weren't smart enough or strong enough to begin it, how do you suppose you could perfect it? Okay? That's why you start, when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you start on top. And then when you start there, why think that once I get there, it's going to change? Like, you got there from believing, from faith, by grace, through faith. We're saved through faith. By grace, you're saved through faith. By grace, by God's grace, not by works, by God's grace, I get to have this awesome life. So that has to be your premise, by grace, through faith. So through faith. So I get there by grace. Thank you, Lord. Every day you should be grateful for the grace of God on your life. Every breath you take is the grace of God. Every oxygen that comes in, that's the grace of God. Every cell that's working like it's supposed to, that's the grace of God. Every time you have a divine appointment or just a regular appointment, that's the grace of God. You being able to live this life is the grace of God. And then you're called to live it through faith. That's when we're operating through what God has for me. By grace, thank you, Lord, through faith. All right? So craziness would be to think, okay, that's how I got saved. Now I'm going to live differently than that. That's crazy. Say, that's crazy. Okay? I know I'm saved by grace through faith, so I want to live by grace through faith. All right? Let's look at the good news. Anybody like hearing good news? I love hearing good news. Got some good news this past week, different things. Like, yes, this is good news. Okay? You know why good news is good news? Good news is good news like this. Somebody told me one time, Miss Pat, actually. She tells me all the time good news. She's like, we're going to Aruba. Every year they go to Aruba. Is that good news for Miss Pat? Anybody ever been to Aruba? Okay? Anybody want to go to Aruba? Come on. Okay? Yeah, we're going to Aruba. Pastor Rachel and I are going in October. Getting all lined up. For real. Yeah. Isn't that awesome? Yeah. We're going to be gone for a week. We're going to be in Aruba. Okay? We're excited about it. So that's good news for me, isn't it? Yeah, that's great news. I'm going to Aruba. Woo! But guess what? That's not great news for my son Josiah. Because he's not going to Aruba. And I'm serious about this. We told Josiah and the kids, we're like, yeah, we're going to Aruba. And he looked at us and he got upset. He's like, I want to go to Aruba. And I said, well, someday we'll take you, but this is mom and I. And he really did. He's like, well, that's not good. Like, he got upset because that wasn't good news for him, was it? No, he's not going to Aruba. But Pastor Rachel and I, we're going to Aruba. And it's exciting for us. And you know, and so I was trying to tell him, I said, we've been here 34, 36 years. We can get it. And he said, well, but he didn't care. He wanted to go to Aruba. All right? But see, that's the thing about good news. Good news is only good if it's for you. Now, I'm excited about Pat going before I go. Okay? We are, and that's good, but still, it's really good. It's good news when it's for me. And see, that's the thing with the gospel. Okay, we're going to do a quick progression here. The gospel. Paul said three times about the gospel. The first time, you know what they called the gospel? He called the gospel of God. He said the gospel of God is what he referred to it as. And I think I have my scriptures here. I don't think I pulled them off for three of them. The second time he mentioned the gospel was the gospel of Christ. He said gospel of God, then he said gospel of Christ. The third time, you know what he called the gospel? He called it my gospel. There was a progression that it went from God's gospel to Christ's gospel to my gospel. Okay? My good news. Say my good news. We as Christians, when we've grown up in church or we've grown up in religion, we hear about God. God's a good God. God has good things for me. God wants good things for me. God is awesome. God this, God that. And then we were growing, and then we get born again, and then Jesus. Jesus. Jesus is, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So we see that the Jesus and the Father are one, and we see that Jesus does good things. Okay, that Jesus came to defeat the devil. That Jesus. Well, you need to personalize this relationship all the way to the point that all that good stuff that God is, all that good stuff that Jesus is, all that good stuff you have with them on the inside of you. It needs to become my gospel, my good news. Okay? I love that Miss Pat has good news. That's great. Pastor and Beth have good news. Many of you guys have good news. But I want good news. Right? Say, I want good news. I mean, can we get real for a minute? Okay? We do. We are supposed to mourn with those who mourn. And I missed a little bit. Mourn with those who mourn and rejoice. Thank you. Rejoice with those who rejoice. So we are supposed to rejoice with others. But guys, we need to get to the point where we realize this is for me. And I'm gonna believe this and receive this like it's for me. Not everybody. Now, I love everybody else, and we are to love everybody else. But God gave this for you. So read it like it's for you. Believe it like it's for you. Stop just looking at others and say, well, that's good for them. And one of these days, get out of one of these days. Say, today. Okay? Today. Go to 1 Corinthians 15, chapter 20. On your way there, say, man, this is good. First Corinthians 15. in verse 20. As I was studying for this and looking through chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, this verse jumped out at me. Because I think a lot of times, especially when things have been going not very well for you, sometimes we always think, well, it's going to get better someday. It's going to get better. But see, the way you change something is you say, right now, I'm going to change. Don't wait until it feels better. Don't wait until it looks better. Say, right now, I'm going to make a change. Okay? And in verse 20 of chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, it says, but now is Christ risen from the dead. When is he risen? Did it say 2,000 years ago? Did it say, and see, remember, did it even say 20 years ago? When this was written, it was years after Christ had died. It says, but now Christ is risen from the dead. So your victory is now, okay? Jesus gave it to you then, but you have it now. Any Cleveland Cavalier fans out there this morning? Okay, some of you there. There you go. Okay. Any Chicago Cubs fans out there? Okay, a little bit more. All right. When your team's won this year, how did you tell people? Did you tell them they won, or did you say, we won? Isn't that right? Cubs fan, we won. That's right. Were you out there playing? No. Do you have the ring on your finger? No. But how do you tell people? You say, we won. That's right. Because you're on that team, right? You weren't there. You didn't sweat. But maybe you sweated while you were cheering them on. That's what it is, right? Yeah, you worked for it. Yeah. No, you didn't work for it. They did it for you. Jesus did it for us. Okay? So we can say we win because he won for us and he gave us the victory. So I can say, I win. Say, I win. All right? If you see on our sign out front, it says, teaching victorious living through faith. All right? Our mission statement says, we believe that Jesus is Lord. The word is absolute. And the word was sent to change our lives as believers. So all that wrapped in together, you have to say, Jesus is my Lord. You have to say, his word is absolute to me. And you have to say, his word will change my life as a believer. Okay? You can't say, my life's going to change because Teresa is reading the word. No. My life can change because Ty is reading the word. My life's going to change because Harvey's reading the word. Your life's going to change when you read the word. Right? And even your pastor, I can't change your life for you. Some people come to me trying to get me to change it, but I can't. Okay? What does it say about you can lead a horse to water? You can't make it drink? It's not biblical, but it sounds really good. Okay? And it is a very good concept. We can lead you, hear the scriptures, but you have to read them. You have to receive them. You have to believe them. Okay? When those storms come, when that bad thing happens, and I should say when, if, okay? But it does say storms are going to come, all right? I'm not saying they have to come. It just says they're going to come. So when they come, you immediately say, where am I at? Wait a minute, where am I at? Where am I at? Oh, yeah, I'm on top. So I'm going to be victorious in this, okay? Let's go to, because you may say, well, you keep saying we're on top. And what about the New Testament? Go to Ephesians chapter 2. And I know we've already been there this morning, but let's go there. We're going to finish up here. Go to verse 6 this time. I'm going to back up a minute. Also, let me remind you, we are super compassionate about people who go through stuff. Okay? Some people may say, well, you guys, you never go through anything. Lies. Okay? Stuff happens. All right? You serve Jesus for 5 minutes, all right? There's a chance for something happening, okay? So it's not just because you know Jesus that nothing's going to happen. No, that's never been promised to us. That would be foolish as well, okay? But you know this, everything you go through, your mindset and your belief has to be, Jesus is with me. I'm not alone. Okay? Now look here, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. It says, and this is the New American Standard Bible, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That word seated is past tense. It didn't say, we'll seat you. It says, seated us. Say this with me. Say, already happened. Raised us up with him, seated us with him in the heavenly places. And then verse 7, let me finish this out. So that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. And then finishing, for by grace through faith, and not that you're saved through faith, and not that of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of the result of works, so that no one may boast. But look at that first verse, verse 6. Raised us up with him, seated us with him in the heavenly places. What does that word heavenly places mean? Okay? In 1 Corinthians 15:49, let me just read this to you. This is the same word heavenly is the same heavenly places, same Greek word. Just as we have borne the image of the earthly, we also bear the image of the heavenly. So that heavenly place isn't when you get to heaven. That heavenly place is now. Say right now. Because in 1 Corinthians 15, it says you're to put on the heavenly image. It doesn't say when you get to heaven. It says now you're to put on the heavenly image. When are we seated with Christ? We are seated now. Because when is Christ risen? He is risen now. So my victory is now. I can be on top now. It is finished now. What's my favorite word this morning? Now. Yeah, ain't God good? So this morning, I want us to have, if you need a mindset renewed, a restart to your mindset, things have been happening, okay? I've prayed with many of you guys since the beginning of the year. Even Pastor Ed and Beth, or Pastor Beth, I was talking to her. She said, lots happened at the beginning of the year. I said, I know. And almost every time, though, if I've talked to you about the things that have happened, I've told you, and I didn't necessarily say a reset, but I just said, put your mind on him. Reset. Where am I? Where am I? I'm on top. I'm with Christ. He's with me. Okay? If you are born again and you know who you are in Christ, declare those things. Say, man, this is new stuff to me, Pastor Zane. I don't know if I can do all that. All you do, literally, you just make a personal declaration. Say, Jesus, say this with me. Say, Jesus, I thank you that you died on a cross and rose from the dead for me. And because of that, I'm a new creation. I can live like you want me to live. And I can have what you want me to have by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay? We are no longer going to be the catfish or the bottom dwellers of Christianity, of anything. God wants you to rise. He wants you to go up. He wants you not just to go up, but to start up and go from there. Got it? I tell you, so this, some of you say, well, I've heard this before, but now live it. Live it now, okay? And God doesn't give us messages just to talk. He gives them because we need them. Somebody needs this morning. All of us can use it this morning, but somebody really needs this morning. Amen.